These people are disciples, mathetes. They are learners, pupils. Learn about Jesus. Learn about your Lord. Learn what he expects of you. Learn what you should do. And in Antioch, this is the first place that they are called Christians. This morning we're in Acts chapter 11, verse 19 down through verse 30. I'm going to say a sentence to you here in just a second, like I do every week. I like to give you a single sentence that is going to summarize the main point of the passage and also include in that sentence what we should do about that truth. And remember, when we study God's Word, I want you just to go ahead and ask yourself this question. God, based on this text, what would you have me to do? Lord, based on this text, what would you have me to do? And why do I say we ought to ask that question? Every time we open Scripture, we ought to pray that prayer. We ought to ask that question. Because the reading of God's Word, the teaching, the preaching of God's Word is not for information. It is for transformation. College is for information. Scripture will change your life. It will change you. It is meant to change you. So don't approach Scripture as a mere academic exercise. We should use the highest academic rigorous study in order to come to God's Word, but we ought to take that and live it out. So God, what would you have me to do with this text, with the truth that arises out of this text? So I want you to write this sentence down, and I'm going to give you an illustration to show you that principle, and I'm going to repeat that sentence for you here. So write this down. The church that is established through the gospel and strengthened in true doctrine should also unite in the work of the ministry. The church that is established through the gospel and strengthened through true doctrine should also be united in the work of the ministry. So there are three steps there if you see those right. So you are born into the church through the gospel. Before I go anywhere else, I want to explain the gospel to you. The gospel is the good news by which you are made right with God. God sends his son Jesus into the world, lives a perfect life, and he dies on behalf of sinners so that sinners like you and I can come to God and say, God, because Jesus died for me, will you forgive me of my sins? God forgives you of your sins, and he welcomes you into his household. That is how you become a part of the church. That is how you are born into the family of God. You are established through the gospel. But then the second step in the church is that you are strengthened in true doctrine. That's what we're doing here this morning. We are strengthening you. We are strengthening one another in true doctrine. We're building you up to make you strong in the faith. But what's the third step there? Should also be united in the work of the ministry. So once we are born into God's family, into the church through the gospel, then also we are strengthened through true doctrine. And then once we are strengthened, we are sent out to do the work of the ministry. As I am growing older by the day and I'm looking at my family growing, I'm trying to just like I do with every situation, try to back out to a 30,000-foot view and see what's going on from a distance. And I try to listen to people who are older than me to tell me what's coming next. I've said this to you a number of times before. Wisdom is not learning from your mistakes. That's just being smart. Wisdom is learning from other people's mistakes. And so I listen to what other people say, and they say, son, you better hold on to these days because these days are going to go by quickly, and before you know it, your kids are all going to be grown up and they're going to be out of the house. And a number of you more seasoned folks, you nod your head and you say, yes, that's exactly what happens. And so I look at my own family, and my oldest is almost 8 years old. In the same amount of time, he's going to be driving. And then just shortly after that, he'd be out of the house, Lord willing, and be married and all these sorts of things. And so I look at that, and you start thinking about the stages of life. When your family has a child, what are you trying to do for the first years there? Keep the kid alive. That's what you're trying to do, right? Just keep this kid alive and keep ourselves sane as much as we possibly can. Keep this kid alive. We want to establish this child as a person. Bring them to a point of stability where they can walk around and not get too badly hurt. They can kind of sustain themselves and take care of themselves, right? Once you get past that stage, it's not all gravy, is it? Then it becomes harder because now your duty is not to establish them as a person. It is to teach them the truth. Teach them what they should expect in this world. Teach them what God expects of them, how they ought to act towards God, how they ought to act towards other people, what they ought to expect once they leave your home. You are building this person up so that they are stable, so that they are strong, so that they have good, solid, righteous foundations in God's word. And then what do you hope? You hope that the person grows into an adult and leaves your house, right? Leave my house and go get a job. You can amen that. It's okay. You want the child to leave your house, get a job, be a productive person, have their own family, honor God with their life, and the process repeats. And we build the kingdom of God like that, right? Isn't there a problem when a child never moves past the infancy stage? They never move past being established as a person. They're an invalid. Don't we say that that's an issue? This is it. How about a person who should have been out of the house a long time ago, should have been established in truth, should be on their own feet, should be out taking care of themselves, but they just hang around? We say there's a problem with this. At some point, you need to go. You need to go get a job. You need to flap your wings and get out of my house. Get off the payroll, right? We say there's a problem. Well, here's the issue. You have the same issue in church. You have the same issue in church where you have people who are, they are born into the family of God, they are established through the gospel, and sometimes they never move past that point because they don't submit themselves to the learning process. They don't actually become disciples. They may be a Sunday morning only kind of person. They come and they're filled up a little bit and then they go, and every week they do the same thing, but never move past the point of after they have been shored up in good theology, in sound doctrine, they never go outside of the doors and actually do the work of the ministry. They stay in the household way past 18 years old. We say it's a problem in real life. Do we say that's a problem also in church? Friends, there ought to come a point where we mature past being a learner, just a learner, and we move on to being a teacher. And we move on to being a disciple maker, and we find out, God, how do you want me to do this work of the ministry? Lord, what is my place? Lord, I don't want to just stay in the house all my life. I want to grow up. I want to be productive in the kingdom. You're going to see here in this text that this is the model that is shown to us, that God first establishes his church through the gospel. He strengthens them through true doctrine. And then they unite together in the work of the ministry. In Acts chapter 10 and 11, the first part of chapter 11, you see a bit of an excursus where Luke discusses the work of the Apostle Peter, the ministry of the Apostle Peter. He moves on from Saul of Tarsus, his conversion in Acts 9. In Acts 10 and 11, it's all about Peter being sent to the Gentiles, to the non-Jews. And Peter goes and he preaches the gospel to Cornelius. They believe, they're saved, he and his household, all of these Gentiles. The report comes back to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem says, this is wonderful, this is great. God has extended the grace that leads to repentance there, the repentance that leads to life. He's extended it also to the Gentile. So now the Gentiles are welcome into the church just as well. We saw that the gospel is not only good for the Jew, it's also good for everybody else too, the Greek and the pagan alike. So now you take a step away from the Apostle Peter, and you see how the gospel starts to work itself out in the Gentile world. And essentially what you're going to see this morning is the birth of the first Gentile church. It's the church at Antioch. Look with me in chapter 11 of Acts, verse 19. Now it says, now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. In these first few verses here, verse 19 through 21, this is what you're going to see. You're going to see the church in Antioch started through the preaching of the gospel. Verse 19, you see that what we read about in Acts chapter 7, when Stephen, the first Christian martyr, remember he was one of the earliest deacons there, and he went out and he's preaching, and the Sanhedrin brings charges against him. He gives an account and he calls them, "You stiff-necked people, you've always been rebelling against the Holy Spirit." They get so furious with Stephen that they get out of their chairs, they take their jackets off, they throw them at the feet of Saul of Tarsus, a young man, and they start picking up rocks and they pummel Stephen to death outside the city. Stephen becomes the first Christian martyr. And because of his murder, Saul of Tarsus, he took it as almost like a mandate to persecute the church. And this persecution broke out in all of Jerusalem. So whereas the church had been isolated in Jerusalem up to that point, now because they're having to run from their lives, they scatter. And so they leave Jerusalem, they go south to Judea, they go north to Samaria, and then you see it. You start to understand, hey, that's the second part of Acts 1:8. When Jesus tells his apostles, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses." Where? In Jerusalem, there's step one. In Jerusalem and Judea, or in Judea and Samaria, step two, and then to the ends of the earth, which is step three. So step two happens not in spite of persecution. The gospel actually spreads because of persecution. You see Philip, he goes to Samaria and he preaches the gospel. And these half-breed Jews believe. I want you to understand this point, because this point is bore out here in this text just as well. As these believers are scattered, they're scattered not only to Judea and Samaria, they go all the way up to Syria, all the way up to Antioch. That's right there at the northeastern corner of the Mediterranean Sea, right as Palestine extends over into Europe, starts extending over. And you see that the gospel starts to spread up north, and it starts to go out, not in spite of persecution, but because of persecution. Very important point for us to understand is this, that there are many ways that God moves his people. There are many ways that God can change the path of your life. Could God change the path of your life through blessing? Sure, he could. He could say, "Hey, here's a job over here. You're going to make three times as much as you do right now. Here it is. Just take it." And he changes your life through blessing. Could God do that? Has he done that? Sure, he's done that before. But that's not the only way that God will shape the path of your life. Oftentimes, God uses affliction. God permits suffering. God permits opposition and difficulty. And he changes the path of your life. That's not happenstance. That is divinely permitted by God to change the direction of your life. God will take the road you're walking on and put up a dead end so that you have to turn and you have to start walking this way that he wants you to walk. So don't despise the times that you're afflicted or you're suffering or going through some sort of difficulty. Understand that God is, what does it say in Romans 8? "For know that God works together all things for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose." So when you are suffering, don't just say, "God, get me out of this. I just can't take it anymore." Say, "God, what are you teaching me through this? How are you changing me through this? Where are you taking me through this?" That's the response of faith. When you say, "Oh God, get me out of this. I can't take it anymore. Get me out of this." That's just whining. But when we say, "God, what are you teaching me through this?" That's a prayer of faith. "God, where are you taking me through this?" So God, through difficulty, takes the gospel up north, even north of Samaria. Now it's going into the Gentile world, all the way up into Syria. So it says in verse 19, "Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia." Phoenicia is the region of Syria, north of Samaria. It's the region of Syria that's right next to the coast. They go up as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus. Cyprus is a big island just off the coast, right there in the Mediterranean Sea, just to the west of Syria, just to the south of Tarsus. So these believers go as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch. Antioch's one of the largest cities there in ancient Syria. And they're speaking the word to no one except for Jews. Apparently at that point, those who had been scattered up to the northern parts in Syria and in Antioch, they had not yet understood that God was bringing the good news to Gentiles. They thought it's only for the Jews. And so they go and they preach to the Jews only, Jesus being the Savior of the Jews. They don't understand Jesus is the Savior of those who are not Jews just as well. But aren't you thankful that there's a little bit of contrast here in verse 20? It says, but there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene. That's an interesting place. Cyrene is on the northern end of Africa. It's on the other side of the Mediterranean Sea. It's just to the west of Egypt. These men from Cyrene probably were worked on ships, and they had ended up in the port of Antioch, and that's how they end up right here. So men of Cyprus from the island just by, and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists, also preaching the Lord Jesus. So these people coming from Cyprus, from the island, and from Cyrene, North Africa, they don't know any different. Jesus is the Savior of all people. And so they come and they preach Jesus to the Hellenists. Now, other places in Acts, you can translate Hellenists as Greek-speaking Jews. That's really what the word Hellenist means. It just means Greek speaker. In this context, it seems to be referring not to Greek-speaking Jews, but just to Greek-speaking Gentiles. Because the contrast here is people who preach Jesus only to the Jews and people who preach Jesus also to the Gentiles. And so these men from Cyprus take hold of where they're from. These men from Cyprus and Cyrene, they start preaching the gospel also to the Gentiles, to the Hellenists, preaching the Lord Jesus. Now you want to circle that word Lord, because you're going to see something very interesting in this verse and also in the next verse. So for the Jew and the Gentile alike, who is Jesus? He's Lord. He's Lord. Jesus is the Savior of all who believe, but he's only the Savior of all those who believe on him as Lord. You have to look at Jesus now as the master of your life, the leader of your life. You obey him. We were talking about it in Sunday school. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commands. That's the definition of Jesus' lordship over you. You keep his commands. And so these men from Cyprus and Cyrene say to these Greeks, if you want God to save you from your sins through the death of Christ, you've got to obey Jesus. You've got to follow him. He must be your God. And so they come preaching to them also the Lord Jesus. Look at verse 21. Very interesting. And the hand of the Lord was with them. And a great number who believed turned to the Lord. Three times in two verses, he uses the same phrase. Now, I don't think Luke, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is unaware that he's being redundant. I don't think he's just not keeping track of his words. I think he's bringing emphasis to that term, the Lord. See, Jesus is Lord. He is master over Jew and Gentile alike. The same saving relationship occurs for anyone who bows to the lordship of Jesus. And so Luke brings great emphasis by repeating that phrase over and again. In fact, that Greek word tonkurios or tonkurion, kurios means Lord. It is the Greek translation of the Hebrew word Adonai. The way that the Hebrews would refer to God was never by his most holy name, Yahweh, because they would not even speak it lest they mispronounce it. In fact, there are not even any vowel pointings there in the Hebrew language to where you can properly pronounce the name of God. So they would substitute Adonai as a polite, a public way of referring to God Almighty. And so when these men are coming and they're preaching the Lord, they are preaching Adonai. They are saying, Jesus is Yahweh. Jesus is God. He's the God of the Jews. He's the God of the Gentiles. He's the one who revealed himself there to Moses, there in the burning bush, saying, I am that I am. This is what it means for Jesus to be Lord. He's not just your master. He is your God. That's why Luke is bringing such great emphasis to this word here. Notice who he gives the credit to in verse 21. And the hand of the Lord was with them. And a great number who believed turned also to the Lord. Who gets the credit for these people turning to the Lord? God does. The hand of the Lord was with them as they preached the gospel. The hand of the Lord. He moves the people's hearts. He opens their eyes. They believe because of the work of God. You will see this as a pattern in the New Testament, that anytime people believe on the Lord Jesus, it is never the preacher who gets the credit. That's just the messenger. Notice also in this text, it says that there were men of Cyprus and Cyrene who preached the Lord also to the Hellenists. Notice that those men of Cyprus and Cyrene, their name is never mentioned. But three times in two verses, Jesus' holy name is mentioned. Lord, 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 it's him. And the hand of the Lord was with them. Luke is going to give every amount of credit possible, not to the messenger, but to the Lord Jesus, the one who gave his life. In fact, when the Apostle Paul is absent from the church that he plants there in Corinth, he writes a letter, 1 Corinthians, to them, and he writes it because they're bickering and they're fighting. That doesn't happen in church, does it? They're fighting and there's divisions and there are controversies, and this is one of the things that they are complaining about. They're fighting because of who their favorite preacher is. One of them says, hey, I follow Paul. And the other one says, I follow Apollos. And then you have these super spiritual people that say, hey, I just follow Jesus. And so you have divisions in the church. And Paul's going to squash that real quick. And he says this in 1 Corinthians 3, 6 through 7. He gives all the credit to Jesus. That's how he squashes that quarrel. He says this, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. Paul says it doesn't matter who the preacher is. What matters is that God is at work. He's the one that deserves the credit. The hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. Verse 22 through 26, what you're going to see about is not that the church is established. Now you're going to see that the church takes action so that this church in Antioch becomes strengthened in true doctrine. Look at verse 22 and 24. It says, the report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and a great many people were added to the Lord. So the church in Jerusalem, they hear that there are people being born again, Jews and Gentiles alike, there in Antioch. So what's their response? They send Barnabas. They take Barnabas and they send him up to Antioch. Now, you're going to see a pattern of this in Scripture. In fact, you already have. You remember when Philip goes to Samaria, he preaches the gospel to those half-breeds, and they start believing, and nobody in Jerusalem can believe it. What do the apostles do? They send Peter and John. Peter and John go up to Samaria and they see what's happening. That's where they run into Simon the magician, the one who tries to buy the Holy Spirit. And they see what's going on and they say, these Samaritans, they truly are believing in Jesus. They're filled with the Holy Spirit. This is legitimate. And so they strengthen them there in true doctrine. So now you see the gospel going to Syria. Word comes to Jerusalem and they say, we're going to send an apostolic representative. Why? That's the question I ask. Why did the church in Jerusalem send an apostolic representative anywhere a new work in the gospel was being born? Two reasons, the second of which I'll harp on for a minute. The first is that they want to validate it. They want to make sure that it's true. Are these Gentiles truly coming to know Jesus? Are these Samaritans truly coming to know Jesus? The second reason is the one that I want to harp on this morning. And it's simply this. They send an apostolic representative so as to shore up these people in true doctrine. So the church is being born through the preaching of the gospel. Believe in the Lord Jesus and be saved. So they have an evangelistic meeting and people are born again. But what happens when the evangelistic meeting is over? You got a bunch of people who say, yeah, I believe in the Lord Jesus. What now? Well, what do we do? We got to strengthen them in true doctrine. We need to sit down and we need to teach these people what they are to do now, how they are to live their life in following Christ. You know, at this point in Scripture, the apostles couldn't say, you know what, we've heard that there's a revival breaking out in Antioch, Syria. Let's get together, call Lifeway, order up 3 boxes of Bibles, make sure they're ESV, send them up to Syria by UPS, it'll get there in a day or two. And once they get that, then we'll follow that up with some Lifeway quarterlies to teach them the true doctrine they're supposed to follow. Oh, and include that DVD series by John Piper and the one by David Platt too. That'll be really good for them. They don't have that, do they? They don't even have the New Testament written yet. Luke's recording this as he's going. So what do? They can't send them Bibles and tapes and tell them to look on YouTube and watch good preaching. They can't do that. So they send an apostolic representative. This is what you're to believe. You're to be built on the truth of God's word. Apostle Paul, the passage that we read a little bit ago, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19 through 22, now read it with this understanding that the church has to be built on the foundation of the teaching of the apostles. That's why they send Barnabas, Ephesians 2, 19 through 20. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, Syrians. Men of Cyprus and Cyrene, you're no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple to the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. The Apostle Paul, I'm sure, is taking into account these things, and he's saying, you know what? The model of the apostles here in Jerusalem is that anywhere the gospel is spreading, they send someone who has spent time with Jesus or spent time with the apostles so that they can go and build them on the foundation of the teaching of the apostles. Why the apostles? They're the ones that walked with Jesus. They're the ones that were charged with writing Scripture, with holding on to the truth, and then disseminating it through the gospel message. So they send Barnabas to go and shore up these people in true doctrine. Why Barnabas? This is an important question for us to answer. Why do they send Barnabas? You've heard that name before, haven't you? Acts chapter 4, we learned about Barnabas. He just kind of comes out of nowhere, it seems, but he's held up as an example of the kind of generosity that's born out of the gospel's work in your heart. It says this about Barnabas, and when I read this, you're going to go, oh. So there are men of Cyprus and Cyrene who are preaching the gospel in Syria. Let's send Barnabas. Acts chapter 4, 32 through 33. Thus Joseph, who was also called by the apostles Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He'll do that very thing here in a minute. A Levite, a native of Cyprus, sold a field that belonged to him and brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. So why did they send Barnabas to these men of Cyprus and Cyrene? Barnabas is from Cyprus. He may know these guys. If he doesn't know these guys, he knows their culture well. He knows the food they eat. He knows the language that they speak. He knows how they communicate. You know what this informs for me? It informs my missiology. It may be a new term for you. Missiology is your theology of missions. How do you do missions? If you ever start studying missiology, you will come across this word, contextualization. Contextualization. We have some missionaries in our crowd right now in our church, and they understand that word very well. See, you don't go to a foreign mission field and turn them into Americans, do you? It's not what you try to do. If you're going to go to Mexico, what do? You learn Spanish, and you learn to like rice and beans and tortillas, because that's the language that they're going to speak, right? They're not going to eat hamburgers. They're not going to talk slang English. So you're going to go and you're going to talk like these people. You're going to understand their culture. You're going to minister to them in their context. There's people from Cyprus and Cyrene preaching the gospel. Gentiles believing. Send Barnabas. He's from Cyprus. He likes their food. He speaks their language. He knows their culture. He will fit contextually. Okay, right now we're just learning. Now it's got to move to transforming your life. Here's how this transforms your life. Many of us would say, well, when God sends me on mission, I wonder where he'll send me. I wonder if he'll send me to Africa. I'd love to go see Africa someday. I wonder if he'll send me to South America. I could really do some mission work in South America. I think I'd like it down there. You know where God's going to use you primarily? Could God send you to Africa or South America? Sure he could, but where do you fit contextually? You fit right here in Mid-County. I have no doubt why God brought me here. One of the reasons why God brought me here. I grew up an hour and 15 minutes from here. I understand. I didn't know you people, but I understood you. You know why? We grew up in the same area. We speak the same language. Once I started eating boudin, we ate the same food, right? Most of us speak the same language. Some of you people have been back in the swamps a little bit, and it's hard to understand exactly what you're saying, but we're getting there, right? But we understand one another, and so we're able to communicate. That seems to be important to God, doesn't it? We're going to have to teach Clint to eat fish. Then he'll be contextualized, right? It's important to God, isn't it, that we speak the language of the people we're ministering to. It was important enough that in Acts chapter 2, when the apostles are filled with the Holy Spirit, what happens? God doesn't give understanding to all the people, the multitudes in Jerusalem. What God does is he gives a special tongue to the apostles so that when they speak the gospel, every person understands it how? In their own language. See, God understands that people communicate through language. They communicate through a culture. Who are you going to be most effective to? In preaching the gospel, your context. Where is your context? If you're a school teacher, your context is the school. You're a refinery worker, your context is the refinery. You know those guys, you know those ladies, you know how they think, you know how they communicate. You can share Jesus with them in a way that I can't. I can't do that. I can't go into refineries. They won't let me anyway, but I can't go in there. They're not going to understand me. They understand you. Look at what Barnabas encourages these believers in Antioch, these first Christians in Antioch. Look at what he encourages them to do. Verse 23 says, when he came and saw the grace of God, he was glad, amen. He's just going to rejoice. This is a good thing. God has shown these people grace. He is glad. And he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. He exhorted them. That is the verbal form of the noun of the name of the Holy Spirit. It's the word parakle. The Holy Spirit's name is parakletos. He's the comforter, the helper, the exhorter, the one who encourages us. Says that Barnabas goes to these first Christians in Antioch and he does the work of the Holy Spirit. He's going to go and encourage them. He's a man full of the Spirit. He does the work of the Spirit. And what is the message that he preaches to these new believers? This is very important. What is the message that he preaches to the new believers? He encourages them to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose. He says, okay, guys, I know you're excited about Jesus, forgiveness of sins, everlasting life. Every bit of it is true, but just understand, things will get difficult for you, so you need to be steadfast. Steadfast in your purpose. You better hold on. You hold on to Jesus right now and you're happy and joyous. You need to hold on to Jesus as your life raft. Because let me tell you about my friend Stephen, who not too long ago was pummeled to death with rocks because of his faith in Christ. So you better be steadfast in your faith. I think Barnabas understood the teachings of Jesus there in Luke chapter 8. You remember when Jesus is telling his disciples about the parable of the soils, the four different soils? And he says the seed of the gospel is thrown out on the four different soils. The first soil is like a concrete path. It never even drops down into the ground. And the birds of the air, the devil comes, takes away that seed. They never even hear the gospel. It hits a brick wall. That's the way some people respond. But those two soils that he talks about are particularly encouraged in this. Hold steadfast, hold steadfast. The two soils that Jesus talked about that really need to hold steadfast are these. In Luke chapter 8, verse 13 and 14, Jesus says, "And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy." Church at Antioch. They hear the word from the men of Cyprus and Cyrene. They receive it with joy. But these have no root. They got no doctrinal foundation. They've got no stability in them. These are those who have no root. They believe for a while, and in time of testing, fall away. So Barnabas shows up and says, stay steadfast. Hold on to the Lord. It's going to get difficult. Verse 14 of Luke 8, "And as for those that fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but as they go on their way, they are choked by the cares and riches and pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature." So Barnabas is going to sit there with them for a year. In fact, he's going to go get help in a second. He's going to sit there with them for a year, making sure that as this church is established in the gospel, that they are able now to walk on their own. They're able to not to run into things. They are secure. They can take care of themselves. Hold steadfast to the Lord. Grow up. Be mature. So he encourages them. Look at verse 25 and 26. Very interesting. The end of verse 24 says, "And a great many people were added to the Lord. So Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul." Why does Barnabas go to Tarsus to look for Saul? Because the church at Antioch is booming. There are so many people, he needs another minister on staff. So he's going to go to Tarsus just to hop across the bay. He's going to go to Tarsus and he gets Saul. Why does he get Saul? Saul knows these people. He fits in this context. And Barnabas knows Saul's acumen. He knows how Saul ministered there in Damascus and how he also ministered in Jerusalem. Remember these words that Barnabas spoke when he brought Saul to Jerusalem, Acts chapter 9, verse 27 and 28. It says, "But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord who spoke to him and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord." Barnabas says, "This work is overwhelming for me. There are so many people in the church at Antioch that need to be grown that I need another teacher on staff." So he goes to Tarsus and he goes and he gets Saul because he knows Saul's a preacher of the gospel. He knows he's going to do it no matter where he's at. So he goes to get Saul. So Barnabas, verse 25, quickly now, went to Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For a whole year, they met with the church and did what? And taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. They taught them. That's what they did for a year. They strengthened them in true doctrine. Build them up. They've been born again. Now build them up. Now teach them. Teach them. This is what God wants you to do. This is what God would have of you. These people are disciples, mathetes. They are learners, pupils. Learn about Jesus. Learn about your Lord. Learn what he expects of you. Learn what you should do. And in Antioch, this is the first place that they are called Christians. Now, if you read history, you would find that it is very likely that that term Christian was not meant as a compliment. It was actually probably meant as a derogatory word. Because everybody else follows Caesar. They're Caesarites, but these guys over here, they don't call Caesar Lord. They call Jesus Lord. So they're Christians. It's used as a derogatory term because they identify so closely with the Lord Jesus. So what happens now? What happens now that Saul and Barnabas are there in Antioch? They are building up the church in true doctrine. What's the next thing that should happen? After the church is born through the gospel, built up in true doctrine, what should be the next step? They should mobilize. They ought to unite together to do what? To do ministry. Do the work of the ministry. Don't just sit here in the pew and get fat and happy on theology. Go outside the door and live it out. Go lead people to Jesus. Look at verse 27 through 30. That's what you're going to see. The uniting of the church in the work of the ministry. It says, "Now in these days prophets came down from Jerusalem to Antioch, and one of them named Agabus," you'll read about him in Acts chapter 21, he comes to Paul and he tells him that he's going to be imprisoned. One of them named Agabus, verse 28, stood up and foretold by the Spirit that there would be a great famine over all the world. This took place in the days of Claudius. Claudius reigned from AD 41 through 54. In his years of ruling over the Roman Empire, there were a number of famines, so it's almost impossible historically to tell you exactly which famine it was. But regardless, Agabus the prophet comes and he tells the church in Antioch, there's coming a famine over all of the world. My question is this: why did Agabus, through the Spirit of the Lord, prophesy to the church at Antioch of the coming devastation in Judea? Why did he tell them? Was it so they could be informed? Or was it so they could do something? Do something about it. There's ministry. There is work. There's help to be given. The church needs to mobilize. So Agabus is sent by the Lord, and he gives this prophetic word. There's trouble coming. So what does the church do? Look at verse 29. So the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judea. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hands of Barnabas and Saul. So what a beautiful picture of the church here. What a beautiful picture of these Gentiles and Jews who are all a part of the church in Antioch. That dividing wall of hostility, ethnic hostility, broken down through Jesus. And now they all show up and they worship together. And you know what these Jews and Gentiles worshiping in Antioch do? They say, our brothers in Judea are about to suffer. So the Gentiles take up an offering. They pass the offering plate. And they take up an offering and they're going to send that down there to Judea to take care of not those Jews. No, they're going to send that offering down there to take care of their brothers and sisters in Christ. They're family now in Jesus. What a beautiful picture of how the gospel can unite people. How do we live this out? How do we live out the pooling together of our money in order to meet needs? You may have never heard of this before. You may have heard of it but didn't understand what it is. But the Southern Baptist Convention, of which we are a part of, participates in what's called the cooperative program. The cooperative program is where every one of the churches in the Southern Baptist Convention gives a portion of their tithes and offerings and they send it to people in need. That's how we fund missionaries. That's how we take care of people in disaster relief and so on and so forth. That work is continued today in the church. What a beautiful picture. What a beautiful picture of what the church ought to be here. The church is born. They are established through the gospel. Then they're built up through the teaching of true doctrine. Then they unite together for the work of the ministry. I think this is what the Apostle Paul is talking about there in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 through 14. Let me read this for you. He's talking of God, of Jesus, the Holy Spirit, giving gifts to the church. And he says, and he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints. That's what Barnabas and Saul are doing. To equip the saints for the work of ministry. For building up the body of Christ until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. That's why Barnabas and Saul were there in Antioch. They're shoring them up because there's going to be people who come and tell them lies, who come and tell them, yeah, Jesus can be your Lord, so can these other gods. No, Saul and Barnabas are there to shore them up and teach them, Jesus is the one true God. He is Lord, Kurios, Adonai. He is Lord over you. Follow him completely. This is what he expects of you, church. He expects of you to take your faith, and he expects you to live it out. So they mobilize to do the work of the ministry. Now, church, three questions for you based on this text. Remember what we're supposed to ask when we come to Scripture. Lord, based on this text, what would you have me to do? Three questions for you. Number one, are you established through the gospel? You're not established through the gospel, you're going to hell. If you're not established through the gospel, you have never taken the good news that Jesus offers forgiveness of sins to all people, Jew and Gentile alike. That's the good news. You can be established, be made right with God. And when you are made right with God, you are brought into his household. What happens after you are truly born into the household of God and you become a member of his church? What's supposed to happen? That's the second question, isn't it? The second question is this: are you availing yourself of every opportunity to grow and to be built up in true doctrine? Are you a Sunday morning only kind of church member? Do you take advantage of opportunities to be taught, to be built up? The pattern of the church in the Bible is that they spent the time with the teachers, and they learn and they grow up in that doctrine. Well, many people, they come to all the classes, they invest themselves in all those opportunities to be built up. That brings you to the third question, because what should you do? You shouldn't just grow up and be fat and happy in a pew, stuffed with all the theological principles. What should you do now? That's the third question. Are you uniting for the work of the ministry when you leave this place? Every one of us finds ourselves at one of those three points. Either you need to be established in the gospel, you need to grow up into the truth of doctrine, and you need to be sent out to do the work of the ministry. The church that is established through the gospel and strengthened through true doctrine should unite together for the work of the ministry. Would you pray with me?